this is any better? Is this better?
No.
No? Okay. I just have to lean in. Yes, yes. Cheryl Sanders. Yes. So, welcome to our last meeting of summer for the Bright Care University of Best Practices Capital Region. We have a fantastic turnout today and some fantastic speakers. Dr. Jose Arevalo is running late and will join us as soon as he can. We have representation here in the room of all the major delivery systems, I believe, and we have such a big crowd that we need to move straight into our programming instead of going around the room and doing introductions. But it's suffice it to say, it's lovely to see so many familiar faces. It's a beautiful thing to be following the Warren Barnes principle in this room. Warren, would you just raise your hand? And the principle is, in this room, we compete against disease and not each other. So we have now been at this in Sacramento for 5 years. We're making some progress. We have wonderful partners from the California Department of Public Health back with us. We have rejoining our team back from maternity, Katrina Taylor. And her team of epidemiology fellows that are joining us. So lovely turnout today. Thank you so much to the many busy professionals who are carving time to work together on what is a hot spot in Sacramento. We have the second worst rate of MIs in the state. And thanks to Dr. Betsy Thompson, we're making headway connecting with the federal government and Million Hearts program on understanding some special contributing factors. And one of those is that we have one of the worst air basins in the country right here in Sacramento. So both the federal Betsy Thompson's federal contacts and state Department of Public Health are helping with that. So we all need to bring our best minds to the occasion. Dr. Baumer, would you be so kind as to introduce our first speaker? Dr. Bill Baumer, UC Davis, Cardiology and American College of Cardiology Governing Board.
Welcome again, and thank you for coming out on a summer day. We appreciate this attendance and commitment that you are all making individually, as well as your contributions for our overall goal. I'm delighted today to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Thompson, who is the Deputy Regional Health Administrator for the Office of the Assistant Secretary for Health in Region 9 and a captain in the U.S. Public Health Service. There's a long litany of accomplishments. I wanted to mention one. She was just the branch chief for the Center for Communicable Disease, and we all realize that that really is a national treasure, and we certainly want to thank her for that service. Throughout her career, Dr. Thompson has focused on healthcare quality and access with an emphasis on disease prevention. We're all here today to see, can we prevent disease? Can we prevent disease in not one patient, but in millions of patients? And I think she's going to address the national efforts at trying to reduce a million cardiovascular deaths. Dr. Thompson.
Thank you. Can you all hear me okay? Am I close enough to it? Okay. It's been a few months, I think maybe since February, since I first presented the draft of the next iteration of Million Hearts, which I think at that time we were calling 2.0. It's now Million Hearts 2022. I wanted to provide you a brief update now that it's moved beyond the concept, which I really shared with you the draft of the plan, but I want to share with you now the final plan. I also want to maybe intrigue you a little bit by promising you that at the end, after I'm done talking with Million Hearts, I'm going to share a simple, cheap, and effective effective way to prevent acute myocardial infarction that you may not have been focusing on, at least you, those of you in this room, within your health plans and service delivery areas. So at the end of the Million Hearts 1.0, the one that we've just completed in 2016, the goal, as many of you know, was to prevent a million cardiovascular events, heart attacks and strokes. The estimate is that we got about halfway there, about 500,000, but fully intend to do an additional million by 2022, so to prevent a million cardiovascular events over the next 5 years. And one, you might ask, okay, well, where are we currently? Many of you know these data, but I suspect that some of you don't. We still have plenty of room to go, plenty of people out there that can use our help in the field of prevention. There's still 34 million people with blood pressure who are the blood pressure is not controlled. In addition, for those with a high cholesterol, we have 35 million people who are not on cholesterol-lowering medications, and furthermore, 42 million of those people are not undertaking any lifestyle modifications that we know could help lower their cholesterol. In addition, 215 million adults consume more than the recommended 2,300 milligrams of sodium per day. I don't think I have to tell you that we are a nation of, I won't use that term. We have a lot of people that aren't as active as they should be. 124 million don't meet the recommended guidelines for physical activity. And believe it or not, we still have 36.5 million people who smoke cigarettes. So lots of room for interventions and improvement still. And we know that to meet the goal of a million heart attacks and strokes, we need to focus on these three priorities that are depicted here. Keeping people healthy, optimizing care, and from having spent some time with you, I know that all of you are focusing on these two priorities and have been. Not as clear to me that many of you are focusing, when it comes to cardiovascular disease, specifically on all of the priority populations. We talk a lot about diabetes here, but I'll show you the other folks that we've identified as a population for you just to think about within your own service delivery area. So it's clear that very bold and specific actions needed if we're really going to prevent a million events by addressing the priorities on this slide. I am not going to go over the specific strategies that have been found effective to address each of these priorities and to reach the established goals for Million Hearts 2022, but you do have these slides available, and more importantly, there's online resources if you need any, in addition to what you already have, that you can link to about any of the strategies for which you wish to learn more. What I do want to stress, though, is that to reach these goals, we must all focus our collective efforts on effective public health strategies. And I know that is really important to all of you. There's too many times where we spend our energy and time on good ideas, things that might be effective, but we know many things that truly are effective that aren't being implemented to the full extent that they can. So just taking on the first task of keeping people healthy, we've set a goal, a national goal, of achieving a 20% reduction in sodium, smoking, or tobacco use, and physical activities in our communities. And there's different strategies for each of those. You all know a lot, probably more than I do, about optimizing care, but I think your presence here today indicates a desire and maybe a need to even learn more. I think we learn something in this room every month about how to improve our performance, for example, on the ABCs. I think there's been a little less time spent on the increase in the use of cardiac rehabilitation, and it might interest you to know that less than 30% of those eligible for cardiac rehab are referred and enrolled. So Million Hearts has set a goal of 70% for cardiac rehab participation, a pretty big jump. This would actually prevent 25,000 deaths and 180,000 hospitalizations annually across the country. And then finally, helping people practice healthy habits starts in the community with good design and access, but can be reinforced by clinicians who equip and empower their patients to adopt heart healthy behaviors. And then the point I wanted to spend just a little more time on is improving outcomes for priority populations. Certainly you all know that there are populations who suffer both more and worse cardiovascular outcomes than the general public. And the reasons for these disparities can be quite complex. However, there are interventions that are effective and will help us all narrow those gaps. That's why this has been established as the one new priority for Million Hearts during this phase of the initiative. We're calling attention to four specific populations, and those are listed on this slide. They're Blacks or African Americans, 35 to 64 year olds, because that's the one group where we're seeing event rates rising, people who have already had a heart attack or stroke, and those with mental illness or substance use disorders. You know, these populations can certainly overlap, and it's not an exhaustive group, it's a list of groups that are disproportionately affected by cardiovascular disease. But they were selected based on three factors that I would encourage you to use thinking about your own populations. First, by the data that showed significant disparity in terms of cardiovascular disease outcomes. Second, by the knowledge that we have effective or promising interventions that address these particular populations' needs. And third, we have partners well-positioned to implement the interventions and connect with those who are affected. So whether you would join us in addressing the needs of these priority populations or identify and address the needs of priority populations that you serve, that's really not important. It's just that we be thinking about this because targeted interventions so often are much more powerful than more generalized ones. So I'm going to wrap that Million Hearts update by just reminding you that there are many resources available to you on the overall Million Hearts website, which is listed here, as well as the clinician's microsite. I mentioned this back in February. Has anyone used the microsite for their organization that they're aware of? If you're not familiar with the concept, and I'm not a real techie by any means, you can kind of think of it as a package of pre-selected syndicated content that's primarily aimed at clinicians, but also communities and consumers. You can embed the site into your website. It will stream the syndicated content as it's updated through your website to your clinical audiences, which means it will appear on your website with your logo and within your website template, not the Million Hearts template. So it can be kind of cool if you're into that.
What? Would you like to go to the link?
No, that's okay. In the interest of time, if you want to later, I'm happy to show it to you, but in the interest of time, we have a pretty full agenda, I'll just keep moving. But there is instructions at this website for whoever you use for your tech. There's instructions about how to embed the code, and they actually are available by phone or email to help walk people through that too. It's a CDC website. All right, questions about that before I move on? Or any of what I've said? If not, I'll move on to the juicy part. So I'm going to start with a riddle. Who can tell me what is as effective as statins, antihypertensives, or smoking cessation interventions that would cost most of your patients nothing and only takes a minute per year? Who's back there? Bingo.
Who said it? Raise your hand.
Kristen.
Dr. Robinson.
Okay. I did not get on the agenda. No. So, how many of you were aware of that? About the efficacy? At least a few of you, and I imagine some of our public health colleagues are as well. Let me just talk through this just a minute. And I'm doing this because, yes, I'm an internist, but first of all, I'm a preventive medicine doc. Prevention's always been my driving passion and goal. The rather striking association between influenza and acute myocardial infarction was recognized back in the 1930s. Some of you may know these data better than I do, but a recent meta-analysis looked at the studies to date and found that influenza-like illness or influenza was significantly more likely in those hospitalized with acute myocardial infarction compared to other hospitalized patients, even when controlling for a host of other factors. In fact, it was about 2 times more likely that they had a preceding influenza-like illness episode. Maybe more interesting is that they found a pooled efficacy of vaccination, of influenza vaccination, of 29%. That is, that it had a 29% impact on reducing for those who have already had one heart attack, a secondary prevention of acute myocardial infarction. The range was 15 to 45% among the different studies, but again, if you look at the various studies with respect to statins, antihypertensive or smoking cessation, and their impact on reducing heart attacks, very comparable data or very comparable numbers. So that's secondary prevention, people that already have known coronary artery disease. The data are less conclusive about primary prevention. But the trends, the data aren't significant, statistically significant in most studies because, as you can imagine, it requires a huge population, et cetera, to get to significance. But there was a consistently a 10 to 15% reduction of acute myocardial infarctions that in the general population as well. And I won't even talk about tertiary prevention, which is, you know, complications that arise from influenza and related hospitalizations. But for those of you who aren't sort of flu vaccine nerds, like some of us in the room, one of the biggest impacts of flu vaccination, I mean, yes, you want to prevent the flu, but one of the other things it does is that if you do contract flu, you're less likely to have more serious cases of flu, less likely to be hospitalized and less likely to die. So that's sort of the tertiary prevention. So we don't have the data on tertiary prevention of acute myocardial infarction due to the flu vaccine, but one would suspect that it's significant as well. For example, we do know that it reduces hospitalizations in various chronically ill populations by 52 to 70%. So you would think, given what I've told you, that we might really widely embrace this strategy. But despite being simple, safe, inexpensive, and widely available in most years, it's not routinely used. We do pretty well with the Medicare age population, and some of you in this room do very well with that population, averaging around 70% nationally. But among adults, we've been hovering at about 40% for quite some time. And certain groups are much less likely to be vaccinated. So superimpose that on the disparities in the priority populations I showed you. We know African Americans are much less likely to be vaccinated. That group where sort of middle-aged adults to some extent, and they're a little younger and middle-aged adults where we're seeing AMI and stroke rates rising, they're less likely to be vaccinated. I think it gives you some food for thought. But I encourage you not to rely on me. Review the data yourself. This slide has the references for the two articles that were recently published in the British Medical Journal, as well as some information from the American College of Cardiology about the flu vaccine being critical for people with heart disease. So I thank you for just bearing with me and letting me put on my public health hat for a little bit and talk about something that I don't think we've talked about here before, which is flu vaccine.
Yes, I've heard of it. I think it's so exciting.
And also, I knew it might be my last chance to get up here and talk to you before the flu vaccine campaign for this year really starts in earnest. So thank you very much. I think I may have time for one or two questions before we go to the next speaker.
Dr. Bonner,
I have a question.
Or comments, for that matter. Yes.
No, my question is, million hearts, and everybody threw their hat in the ring to try to achieve that, and we got 50%, 500,000 lives saved. Why did we fail, or what areas did we fail, so that when we look at the next rollout of it, we can, let's say, focus on those areas where we didn't quite meet our target goals?
Yeah, I wish I could tell you that I had more granular data to look into that. I do know that part of it was and why there's a new recommendation to focus on the priority populations is going over after where we have the highest likely prevalence and incidence of new events. So that is part of it, but I think that is only part, and the evaluation continues to go on. So I don't have a really good, clear, concise answer for you. I think, you know, is it glass half full or half empty? I kind of want to celebrate the 500,000, though I'm very sad that we didn't make it to a million. I have not seen data, to be very honest. I haven't seen data that will tell us what the estimated number, if we really focus on those priority populations, how much further we can get.
But maybe for the newcomers here, because we do have some newcomers, you can talk about the top three things that everybody has to nail. Blood pressure.
Well, I mean, the ABCs, which are on this slide, I think are what you need to really think about if you haven't already. And that includes the use of aspirin when indicated, controlling blood pressure, controlling cholesterol, and smoking cessation at a minimum. And there are plenty of tools and resources, ideas for you in the Million Hearts website as well as other places. Many of you have great sites yourself within your health plans and organizations. So those are kind of the bare minimum. And I think there was there one other question?
Just intellectual curiosity question. Given apparently older people don't respond as well from an immune standpoint to the flu vaccine, is there any data in the research publications as far as the positive effect of flu vaccines on older people?
There is. I don't have it in the back of my brain to tell you, but and that is part, you know, many of you know that we've gone to a high-dose flu vaccine recommendation for those 65 and older, and the ACIP recommendations, to my knowledge, we haven't had a finalized for 2017-2018, but their recommendation was to continue the high dose for the elderly so that they could try and help mount a better response. Still, you know, we know it's effective. I don't have the numbers in memorized to tell you how effective in terms of preventing hospitalizations and mortality. All right, I think we'll move on, and we are going to switch the order of the presenters, mainly because Dr. Revelo, we're hoping we'll be here before Deborah Orgos Kent speaks to us. But it's my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Skye. Joseph Skye is the Chief of Cardiology as well as the Medical Director of the Heart, Lung, and Vascular Center at David Grant U.S. Air Force Medical Center on Travis Air Force Base, where he serves veterans, active duty, military, and their families. Dr. Skye received his bachelor's from Pacific Union College, his MD from Loma Linda University, and completed training in internal medicine as well as cardiology in the U.S. while he was in the U.S. Air Force. Before becoming a cardiologist, Dr. Skye served as chief of the internal medicine branch at the U.S. Air Force School of Aerospace Medicine. I thought that was kind of interesting, where he monitored and kept our nation's pilots and those of allied air forces healthy and fit for duty. So I think his real reason perhaps for being here is the next part, which is that he really specializes in integrating modern medical treatment with evidence-based preventive medicine. Again, works focusing more on military pilots as well as unmanned aircraft operators and commercial pilots. They fully embraces Western medicine and he enjoys finding patients that are willing to use diet and lifestyle in medicine. So he's excited to be practicing at this time when science really is showing the proven value of complementary preventive cardiology. Dr. Skye, thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity to be here, and I'd like to thank Hattie for this especially. So today I will focus on the fact that I grew up in the Adventist culture and spent many of my formative years in what has been known as, been labeled as a blue zone, where people are likely to live to be 100 and enjoy old age healthier than average.
Can you somehow get closer to the mic?
Is that better?
Yes.
Can you hear me? There. Okay.
still need to project. Louder.
I will. Is that better there? A little bit louder. So one of my mentors for all of us in cardiology is Dr. Valentin Pfister, who recently expressed these thoughts here during one of his editorials, that the time has come where we no longer should just tell patients what to do, that we need to involve patients and we need to explain why, so that patients can become part of the treatment plan. And to me, that's what this talk is about, is explaining why we are where we are with regards to the state of cardiovascular disease in the United States, and for that matter, other developed countries. And for me to explain that, I look back at 1900, and if you look, most of the leading causes of death were infectious. And as our first speaker pointed out, the flu vaccine has been one of the major advancements in modern medicine. And as we've eliminated infections as being one of the leading causes of death, we're now in a period where cancer and heart disease have become number one. And of course, the obvious observation is made that now that we live long enough to develop these diseases, of course we have to die from something. But my question today, and what I will be asking, will be, how long can we live? What is our genetic potential, if you will? And then as we live longer, what level of health can we enjoy? How do we eliminate morbidity if we can? And I think that Dr. Brunwald, in one of the leading cardiology textbooks, points out the following stages of disease that we have gone through. And for the United States, we went through the first stages very quickly, where we eliminated famine and solved public health issues. And in the 1930s, we entered into a phase that we've now looked back and labeled as the age of degenerative and man-made diseases. And we are currently in the phase where we are reducing or delaying these degenerative man-made diseases. And looking at this a little bit more, the period of degenerative man-made diseases was ushered in as we were solving other problems. As we developed cars and public transportation, and as we replaced ice boxes where we had to go and get ice and lug it back to our house with first gasoline refrigerators and then electric refrigerators, we replaced washing machines. Everything became mechanized to the point that we hardly had to do anything anymore. And at this same time, leisure time became more available. We picked up habits like smoking, and food became much more readily available. As food became modernized, we were able to store it and have it available. And then also, as you'll see here in a few slides, we also modernized our food, and perhaps some of these things led to the development of these man-made diseases. And then in the 1960s, we entered into where we started to solve these problems. We delayed these diseases by developing treatments, primarily medications, treating hypertension at first, then hyperlipidemia, and now diabetes. We also worked at developing treatments for cancer, things like bypass surgery, stents. We started telling people not to smoke. Another Air Force physician, Dr. Ken Cooper, as many of you might know from the Cooper Institute, in the 1950s, also at the School of Aerospace Medicine, he was the first to note that aerobic activity probably had a role in reducing the morbidity and mortality from cardiovascular disease. And he advocated this type of exercise first for Air Force pilots, and then it was moved up to the general population. And as you can see, the inflection points are there, that we started to reduce the morbidity and mortality from cardiovascular disease by these treatments and changes in our lifestyle. Now, unfortunately, we are perhaps entering a fifth phase of disease that's never been seen before, where we have inexpensive, highly processed calories that are so readily available that we are able to, if you will, out-eat the cures. And smoking cessation has slowed, and we have perhaps developed a culture where we almost have an over-reliance on medications and treatments. And this is alarming to some experts, that we are entering into this new phase. Perhaps it'll be called the age